Hello, everybody. Welcome to another edition of Talking Elite Fitness. I'm Sean Woodland, joined by Tommy Marquez. Tommy, how you doing?
You know, sports teams aren't doing great, but I am, so.
There you go. And you're enjoying your last couple of days of being not a father.
Yes, so indeed.
Life is about to change, my friend. And proudly featuring Lauren Khalil. Lauren, how are you?
I am great. I am wearing my heated blanket right now, so life really? Is pretty good.
It dipped into the 70s here, and it was a little overcast, so I'm like, okay, it's officially fall. It's getting, it was a little chilly. I got the, I had to put on a long sleeve shirt and, you know.
Oh.
Right. I know, we're really roughing it out here. But we got a lot of stuff we want to talk about today. Have some highlights from some competitions that went on this past weekend. Talk about that. Have some other headlines, things going on that you may have missed from this past week. And later on in the show, we are going to be talking with, well, Lauren and Tommy spoke with, four-time Canada's strongest woman, Sam Beliveau, who is going to be competing at the Rogue Invitational, and I believe has the world dumbbell record press. I want to
Yes,
watch her do that. I think at the Arnold Strongwoman Classic, which, by the way, like the Arnold Strongwoman Classic may have been more entertaining than the Strongman Classic. There were so many great moments in that, and I'm really looking forward to seeing them, you know, on the big stage now at the Rogue Invitational. But before we get into that, we want to thank, we have new sponsor alert, so we have to hit the new sponsor horn. That is Kreatures of Habit, high protein overnight oats. This stuff is fantastic. They come in little packets, and literally you'd like put it, they get you, you have a container, you put in the container, put some water in it, put it in the fridge, forget about it. You have a meal for either the next morning or the next day. I've been using this stuff for every day, really, for the past 3 weeks now. They have 30 grams of protein, plant-based, probiotics and prebiotics, omega-3 healthy fats are in there. It's dairy-free, gluten-free, no GMOs, and it's soy-free. This stuff is absolutely great. They have a bunch of different flavors that come in packets. You can check them out at creaturesofhabit.com. That's creatures with a K, creaturesofhabit.com, or you can scan that QR code that is on your screen right now. We have a code. It's TEF. You're going to save 20%. And if you're someone who's pressed for time during the day, you for either he's going to be soon, literally it takes 2 seconds to set up, pour it in, water, stir it, fridge, done.
Talk about serendipitous timing, right? Mm-hmm. Like I'm about to basically need a quick grab and go breakfast. Really, I don't know if I'm going to be able to see straight in a few weeks, but like just having this as part of the working into the daily routine for me and my wife now has just been awesome. Like you mentioned, the flavors are great. Maple, I got a little chocolate peanut butter one. There's like a strawberry walnut that's fantastic. Mm-hmm. Don't even have to worry about like adding sweeteners or anything like that. Just dump it. I use like 3/4 of a cup of Fairlife and another quarter cup the next morning to kind of like mix it in. Another extra 13 grams of protein.
Yep.
Beautiful.
Great stuff.
Creatures.com. Individually packaged. So it's really easy to travel with. Yeah. And it can fit into your purse, fit into a travel bag, and gives you a guaranteed breakfast that's going to get your protein in, because sometimes you don't know when you're going to get it next.
Or for me, midday snack. It's my midday snack around 3 o'clock.
Good afternoon, Marquez.
Exactly. Afternoon, Marquez. Yeah, don't have the coffee with it, but definitely have the afternoon snack. So check them out. Creatures of Habit. That's creatures with a K.com. Our code is TEF. You'll save 20%. Okay, let's get into the headlines for today. Last week, we talked about Roman Khrennikov making the announcement on his Instagram page that he's going to miss the rest of the offseason, hopefully be ready for next season. And then we found out what exactly that it's going to be. And the Barbell Spin had this on their Instagram page, but he's going to go, Roman is going to undergo surgery for a hip injury.
Yeah. Labral tear, camp morphology, which involves the femoral head impingement in the joint. Usually those two things go hand in hand. Some of the impingement or the impingement and the morphology of the femoral head can affect and cause a labral tear. Mm-hmm. You know, in his Instagram, he states he's going to be ready and focusing on the season. You know, the typical, honestly, it's that, you know, most places will tell you 4 to 6 months, but like it can be anything between 4 and sometimes a year plus. I've had friends with labral tears that it took years before they were able to get back to a movements, patterns, and strength that that they had before. And it really depends on the sport, right? With the hip, like with the hip socket, you see these types of injuries, whether it's like running, soccer, football, that require dynamic movement, or if you have like the shearing forces of like load, which we have quite frankly more so than most sports, I think, in terms of the variety. It's gonna be tough. You just hope Roman's able to get healthy. It's not as serious as it can be. It was a second opinion that took them to find it in the first place. So hopefully it's not crazy, crazy bad, and they caught it, you know, at a stage where they can fix it pretty quickly. But either way, you know, unfortunate timing, and you know, hopefully it wasn't too painful, because that stuff can really trip you up.
Well, now he's saying, isn't he, that he's going to be ready for the season?
Did he announce a surgery date? Because if it's the 4 month, he might be okay.
Yeah, I imagine he's probably already had it, or it's pretty close. Well, it's probably something you want to get done as quickly as possible and get that clock starting.
And I imagine Roman Khrennikov, with you know one hip, can probably qualify for the quarterfinals in the Open.
Yeah.
I mean, he did pretty well on one foot a couple of years ago. So
yeah, and he says it's something that he's had since semifinals. So like, and who knows where the injury was relative to, you know, when it happened in semifinals, like if it progressed or if it healed and went back and forth, and where it is now, relatively speaking. But it's definitely something he's been able to manage. So it's a little bit different though when you're rehabbing from surgery versus you're trying to manage an injury.
Yeah. Okay. Well, the next thing that we're going to talk about, and Lauren, you brought this to our attention the other day, is that the next big off-season competition after Rogue is the Dubai Fitness Championship. And Roman was actually scheduled to compete not only in that, but also the Invitational. Well, now they've changed. Dubai has their qualification process. What happened with that?
Yes. So originally they had stated, I think on Competition Corner, where, you know, everybody's logging their scores, that 30 men and 30 women would qualify through the qualifiers. So that was the communication for the athletes, the understanding. And then as they were going through the verification of, you know, scores, finalizing the leaderboard, there was an update on Competition Corner that said that now they are taking the top 28 men, 28 women, and then sending invites to 2 men and 2 women.
Have those invites already been sent out?
Supposedly
they have.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Tommy.
No, you got it.
No, yeah. So the Barbell Spin also did report the names of the athletes. On one of their Instagram posts, they tagged the 4 athletes.
Yeah, Spencer Panchik, Karin Frejova. Mm-hmm. I can't remember the exact name. I think is it's like Redwan El Gadouini.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. So. And Julia Kato as well. So, you know, Karn's won this event multiple times. Julia Kato is technically from South America, but trains and has trained and lived in the UAE. Gadouini is, if you go to his Instagram profile, claims to be the fittest Arab, and I believe is pretty accomplished overseas. In the past, Dubai has had the UAE national champions competing there. That was as far back as the sanctional era. So when you had like Shahad Boudebs or Mahmoud Salan competing, they typically tried to have someone somewhat of Arab background competing, representing that region. So that makes sense. How this happened, and Lauren and I were talking about this earlier today. Is it the biggest deal that 2 spots got swapped for special invites? Kind of. 2 spots, not huge, but you don't want this to con- to be the rule where suddenly you're swapping out qualification rules and moving the goalposts and changing it after it started. I think that's a dangerous precedent to start for events to be like, it's our qualifying process. We can do whatever we want. And you have athletes and people signing up under the premise that here's what I need to do to make sure I get there and get an opportunity to compete. And quite frankly, because it's Dubai, have an opportunity at a significant prize purse, right? Mm-hmm. And then you meet those standards and then you're only told after the fact that suddenly, you know, you're not good enough. You didn't do it. So realistically, it's unfortunate, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that's kind of what you're going to get sometimes with these off-season competitions. As you venture out of the more mainstream ones, Dubai's hasn't typically run qualifiers. They've more so run on invite basis. Mm-hmm. Even from like, even when the sanctionals era, you think about the 2018 Dubai CrossFit Championship.
But they've had qualifiers for the past couple of years.
I not off the top of my head.
Like, I know they definitely had qualifiers last year.
It's possible that they did for last year, but even you go back to 2018, like a lot of the people there competing for that first games spot were invite only.
Hey, well, it's been like a mix, right? They've kind of had qualifiers and a mix of invites. Well,
a lot of it's been invite, and you know, there is a host of athletes that go there year after year. They've typically allowed, you know, past winners to come if they want, and you know, it kind of varies, but they haven't had as clear and clean of a qualification process as some of the other ones in terms of running regular qualifiers that you get into and you know what you're getting into year in, year out. And quite frankly, it's, you know, kind of up to them how they want to run their competition. And in years past, it's been more of like an invitational type event, which isn't necessarily an issue, but people are rightfully upset about the fact that you move the goalpost once you stated it was one thing, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's unfortunate. And I mean, what, I guess there is time maybe between now and then that people could withdraw. I mean, Roman withdrew.
Yeah.
So it's possible that those people,
but do we even know if those people are going to be backfilled? Like, I don't even know
what the process would be like.
Yeah. It's in December, the second weekend of December. Yeah.
But I think I'm on this. It's like, once you set it, that's it. You're fine. You don't, but don't move it in the middle.
Yeah.
Right. And like, people in the comment section, and I'm not saying that the comment section is where all of the great info is, but just kind of hearing the dialogue between people and, you know, what the hot takes are. Mm-hmm. Some people were saying, well, who cares? The competition can do whatever they want, and these people wouldn't be in contention for the podium anyways. But it's not about that. Like, Dubai historically pays out for event wins. And I think that they pay all of the athletes that not all of the athletes.
Yeah. No. Sorry. Right. I'm not
all of the athletes.
Yeah.
All of the athletes get paid. So it's like, it doesn't matter that they were 29th and 30th. Right. These athletes are now missing an opportunity that they were communicated in advance that they would have had. And I would say
that, like, do you think it's meaningful that someone who finished in the top 10 would potentially be missing out? And most people would say, yeah, right? Like, someone who finished 7th or 8th, like, at a big event like that, misses out because of a weird qualification adjustment like this. And they're like, okay, well, functionally, as far as like prize money is concerned, 7th through 30th get the same amount.
Dang.
So yeah, like this year in particular, the prize purse is very top heavy. So I don't think that, you know, just because they would have been 30th, you know, is the best argument, because part of it too is like, for these athletes on the, you know, the up and up, I think it was Julia Blaszczykowska and Nordka Bleeker, I think, were the two women. And then Morteza Sedegat, and then another Greek, Yorgis, I can't remember his last name, were the two athletes on the way out. Like, Morteza qualified for the games 2 years ago out of Asia, but couldn't go because of a visa issue. Like, Nordka Bleeker was on no shortcuts, but has been on the team scene at a high level. So these are athletes that are looking for very real opportunities to compete. And, Yeah, you don't want this to be suddenly be a trend that's made allowable for people, because if we're actually trying to move the sport forward and like have the roots of professionalism spread as wide as possible, like stuff like this has to start to fall by the wayside.
Agreed. Okay, well, let's talk about two competitions that did already happen. And this past weekend, we had two, one in the United States, one in Australia. We had Crash Crucible. That was going on, and Colton Mertens for the men, he was your top finisher. Brittany Weiss for the women, and then Taylor Self, Fisa Gaffey came in second. Chris Ibarra and Lydia Fish come in third. And look, that's a competition that is, you know, everyone seems to like it. It's been around for a while, and you talk about like professionalizing the sport and you making it better. It seems like that one is starting to creep up into, you know, I don't think anybody would put it in like the rogue Dubai Wadapalooza category yet, but it's, you know, maybe a step down and approaching that level if it stays on this trajectory. You know, that's kind of, those are the kinds of things that you like to see from competitions that have run for a while. And I think the NorCal Classic is kind of the same way.
Yeah.
Like they've just been doing their thing, and every year they build sort of incrementally. They don't try to swing, they don't try to go too big too fast and add too much, you know, from year to year. And have been building the slow momentum. So, you know, congratulations to everybody who finished on the podium there. And then the other one that happened was the Down Under Championship, which got some attention as well. Amy Kringle.
That's happening this weekend.
I've been seeing a lot of social media. So that's going on. But these are, that's another one that same thing as maybe it's been, I think it's been around at a higher level, like maybe above
regionally.
Yeah, regionally speaking, but you know, these are two up and coming events that, if this season structure continues, right, these are two more opportunities that athletes could have to, you know, make a little money outside of the game season.
Yeah,
Down Under. Emmanuel and Ricky are on a team, and they're putting out some fun content right now together.
I mean, Down Under, I want to say it's been going for a decade. I might be confusing that with another event, but
it was a sanctional one time, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a sanctional. I was actually supposed to go to that before COVID hit.
Okay.
And but that is a long running event down there, and historically a lot of the DNA of the people behind the scenes working that have helped out with like the old like Pacific and Australia regional back in the day.
Yeah.
So I think the athlete list is more, isn't probably as star studded. There are a lot of athletes that I do think like, oh, hey, if they do really well here, you know, maybe take a flyer on them and pay attention to what they could potentially do this season. Amy Kringle qualified last year, going to be down there, but then you have athletes like, oh, Brittany Weiss, you just mentioned, and the roster could change, right? Because travel there is pretty significant. M. DeRoy, who went team this year after qualifying 1 year as an individual. Jesse Smith, who's been on the Invictus teams. Laura Clifton, who was a games qualifier a few years ago. Linda Kiesman was a rookie this year. Marty Sykes, who's been on multiple top 10 teams at the games. On the men's side, Peter Ellis, rookie. Royce Dunn, who's, you know, one of the well-established men down there. And Morteza as well, who unfortunately was on the wrong end of the qualification process in Dubai, has a spot down there as well. So
with some of these individual athletes that go team in this event, would it be safe to kind of compare this to sort of like Australia's or the Pacific region's Wadapalooza, given the timing of it?
Yeah, I could see that, because
they had some fun teams last year.
Yeah, they did.
Wasn't Tia supposed to compete?
Yes, but she was the year she was pregnant.
That's right.
She was supposed to be on a team with Brooke Wells and I think Ellie Turner.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's right. Yeah. And still wound up going, but just didn't compete.
Is this where we got the hombres for the first time? That name with Noah and Chandler.
Yeah.
And they usually stream this, don't they? Like, it's usually from what I remember, they've streamed this in the past and it's looked pretty good.
Yeah, they have. Oh gosh, it's a team. Your mom's ex-boyfriend.
Naming your fantasy team is about as fun as naming your fantasy football team. It's like very important.
Yep. Oh man, it's fun.
All right, Well, we'll keep an eye on that down under championship. My apologies. For whatever reason, I was under the impression that it already took place, but that is this weekend. Another bit of news, drug sanctions that we missed. It's been kind of quiet, which is a good thing on the drug sanction side of things, but there were a couple. Jamie McGarva, who's a master's athlete who finished second in the 50 to 54 year old division in Duraball. Diana Vicitelli at the Fitland Fitness Festival. Same thing. She was the fittest woman in Venezuela
in the open. Yeah.
And has been at the semifinals a couple of times as well. So those are the two that came out, but have there been any others? There's nothing. I can't remember anything coming from the team. I haven't. Nothing.
Yeah, not much.
So this is, I mean, if these are the only two, that's got to be a
record.
Because usually there's a handful. I don't know.
It really comes down to how many tests were administered and how much money was spent on it. You know,
also because, good point.
You know, as drug testing resources increased in the sport, we saw a significant increase in the, you know, the sanctions. And I think, you know, with a lot of money getting pulled from the sport in the recent we've had a little bit quieter years, but.
Was the year they did targeted testing in Europe where they really went after a bunch of people? Is that 2016?
Yeah, 2016 or 2017.
It was one of those two.
Yep.
Because there had been, I don't know if we're going to ever see that again, but that was when it was, I think the money being spent was, at least on that side of things, was probably at a tight.
Well, yeah. And you had people just basically bailing out of the competition.
It was pretty obvious. Some people, hey, do they test everybody after this?
Yeah.
No, not just the podium. Oh, no, they test a lot of people. Oh, my back. I got to go. Too bad I can't stay. Oh, man. Okay. Well, those are the only two drug sanctions. And that gets you caught up on the headlines.